Hello and welcome to the Domino Theory television program. My name is Gil Francis, and I will be your host for this particular episode. I'm going to remind you once again that the Black History Celebration is coming up pretty soon, and that will be held on the 16th of February at the Hamilton Recreation Center, which is located at 1900 Gary Boulevard, corner of Steiner Street here in San Francisco, California, from 1 until 4 o'clock on that third Saturday in February from 1 until 4. Be sure and come by free of charge, and there will be some food. So that should encourage you to stop by and see what we're doing. Hopefully it'll be something a little bit different from last year. We didn't have much of a turnout, but we are going to see if we can increase that number and get some more people to participate. I was reading the Bay View newspaper, and one thing that really caught my eye is the fact that the United States is deploying troops to over 35 African countries. Now, that's not local news, but it's local news as far as I'm concerned, because they're all black people, and I don't quite understand why we are involved in as many military actions as we are. And then again, I do, because I have been a soldier myself, and wherever they send you is where you go. That is mind-boggling. Over 35 countries in Africa will have United States troops on the ground. Can't beat that. And it's all in the name of looking for who? Al-Qaeda. Thought we killed bin Laden, but apparently we didn't. There are some more bin Ladens running around here somewhere, so we have got to find those people as soon as possible. The other thing that caught my eye on the front page was the Supreme Court rules that cops can be filmed in the state of Illinois. It was a law that said that if you filmed a police officer in the line of his duty while he was doing his duty, you could be sentenced to up to 15 years in jail. And I think that was just ludicrous. I don't know how long that law had been on the books, but the Supreme Court overturned it, and they stuck with the lower court, I think. As a matter of fact, they didn't overturn it. They stuck with the lower court's ruling that you can film a police officer while he's doing his job, and hopefully he's doing it properly. So we don't want to get hung up on semantics, but there are some questionable activities going on out there that should be filmed. And me having a camera, I would like to, of course, see that that stays in place. Now, the other issue is the Speaker of the Assembly, a gentleman by the name of John Perez. And what Mr. Perez wants to do is stop the media from interviewing state assembly people after they have their sessions. This has been a long-standing, something that happens all the time. When the session is out, people come out to the hall and they have interviews. So apparently he's pushing this back, and he doesn't want this to happen because it's been happening too often, or whatever the situation is. But he doesn't feel comfortable with it, so I think that is going to be ruled illegal also pretty soon. As far as medical marijuana is concerned, there was a club, I won't mention any names, but they were kind of nice, and as much as they gave veterans, especially veterans that were disabled or had illnesses that were life-threatening or what have you, terminal illnesses such as cancer and HIV, they gave them free medical cards so that they go to cannabis clubs and buy their medicine. However, that practice was stopped, and this particular club went up to $75. Like, last year was $0 for veterans on Veterans Day. This past Veterans Day, it was $75. What is up with that? And then we want to know why the federal government is closing all of these places. Well, because they're being abused. And, you know, I have been a long advocate of medical marijuana since back in the day before it was even thought of as medical marijuana, but as opposed to taking pills as, such as Vicodins and Percocets or what have you, I think it's a lot easier on the body to eat a brownie or a cookie and get the relief that one needs. This issue is going to be an ongoing issue, of course. Several states have legalized marijuana for social purposes, such as Colorado, and I'm not sure what the other state was, but inevitably it will happen. I'm sure it didn't happen before because of the liquor industry, and it is incredible. I was in New Orleans over the past month, and there's actually a drive-in daiquiri place. You can drive in and get a daiquiri and drive out. Like you go through like McDonald's drive-thru. Yeah, you do that. And I thought that was so incredible. But anyway, I don't know what the statistics are as far as accidents in Louisiana is concerned, but I'm sure they're not what they should be or could be. The other thing that I wanted to point out to you is that Proposition 13 didn't pass, and it didn't pass by a slim margin. What that was all about was that labeling food and genetically grown food, they put substances in food to make them grow more or taste better or what have you, have a different color, and it's not really that healthy. But what advocates are saying is that they should at least tell you what you're about to eat. But the forces that be, the powers that be, spend a lot of money to defeat Proposition 37. So now what comes up now is that those people should be boycotted. Even if half of the population that shops and is not comfortable with what they're doing with our food, would boycott these people, they would have a lot of problems. So let's see which way that ball bounces, and we'll see what happens with that. We're going to show you some of our trip to New Orleans. We had a fantastic tour guide. Mr. Harold X. Evans was our tour guide, and he showed us around New Orleans and some of the places that we went to. You're going to be a little bit surprised, but they do have historical value. Mardi Gras is coming up pretty soon in New Orleans. They're also going to have the Super Bowl, which I wish I could have stayed for. Not the Super Bowl, but the Mardi Gras. I haven't been to one in quite a while, but they're going to be having a really good time in New Orleans up until about the next 2 months or so. I guess everything's going to be what you might refer to as rocking, really going on. So, if you're in that area, go down and be safe, of course, but have a good time, and don't take any wooden nickels, because there are quite a few of those floating around. We're going to talk with Mr. Harold X. Evans, and I'll see if I can find some other stuff to sneak in on you, and I'll be back.
Okay, thank you. Talking to Mr. Harold X. Evans of New Orleans, Louisiana, one of our favorite people, of course, and Harold's going to relate just a few of his experiences in the acting profession to us. He's been an extra in a lot of movies. Well, not a lot, but quite a few. And he's also done some other stuff. So I'll let him tell you about it. What's up, Harold?
Hey, man. Good to be with you, Sonny. No, I haven't done much extra work. I'm an actor. I've always been hired and paid as an actor, not the background people. So I've had these, what I call cameo roles in a number of films, you know, where I might say something like, they went that way. Or, you know, in other cases, a little more dialogue with something. But I've been fortunate in that in most of the bit parts that I've done with the stars. So we made the final cut. My part was usually, always, in fact, included in the final scenes. One of the last full-length movies I did was The Final Destination 4. You know, the kids being stalked by death and that sort of thing. I like that. That was fine for me because They picked me up from my house in a limousine, you know, for a poor boy from New Orleans. This is nice. Took me to the airport where they hold up the sign with your name. Limousined me to, you know, a resort hotel. It was fun. Flew me first class from New Orleans to Orlando, Florida. So that was nice. I've done TV things, a number of pilot programs, and some programs that made it, like Treme. I've done background voices for a TV series, primarily Treme. I've done Orleans. I've done Memphis Beat. Some of them, I can't remember the names, Breakout Kings. So I've done a few of those, and it's always fun for a stage actor. I'm primarily a stage actor. When you get the movie scenes, it's different, but it's fun working in those situations. I've worked with some nice people, Richard Gere, Denzel Washington directed me in The Great Debaters. I like that. I like working with Denzel. That was the first audition, and I hate auditioning because I'm a very poor auditioner. You know, you get this stuff, you gotta learn it overnight pretty much, and when you have a full-time job like I've generally had, your best hours are behind you, and then you have to go and try to give a meaningful performance for a casting director or for director. I've had one audition that was so bad. The director put his head down on the desk. I knew it was bad, but I said, hey, that's the way it goes. You just do what you can. But it's enjoyable, and the pay is nice, but you can't make a living at it unless you're doing it every day. And people in the business can tell you, if you make plenty of money, you get good residual checks. If you don't make plenty of money, you get some checks like I get for like 2 cents, 25 cents, 35 cents, $2. You definitely can't live on that.
But that is a steady cash flow, right?
Well, when the checks come, you can call it cash if you want, but it isn't very much. The initial pay is the best pay, unless, like I said, you get a big part with a big paycheck. A lot of Hollywood actors, they look for those checks because they've had good paydays to begin with, so their residual checks are good. It's nice to have a union, and for those states that want to eliminate unions, not a good idea. People who work need unions. Now, unions can be a pain in the back, but their intentions should be good, and they can be helpful to the workers. So I support unions. My union is SAG-AFTRA right now. I'm not making any money with them right now because I'm not working right now. But it's a good union. I remember working once for a company. They came into town to film something. And I worked with them briefly, but the film never did come out. They just disappeared. I didn't get paid. It was a couple of years later, I heard from the SAG attorney in Los Angeles. He said, how are we going to see about getting you paid? 2 years later, I wound up getting paid, and that was good. And that's what a union can do for you. So, I support unions.
Family member. Very good. Anyway, the topic of discussion was the black filmmaking industry and quote-unquote black filmmaking industry, because very few of us do that. Spike Lee, Tyler Perry came up, and I really didn't know that Tyler Perry was from New Orleans, but I do know who he is and what he's doing in Atlanta, partially. I didn't know what his contributions were as far as other young black artists were concerned, but we get some insight from our guest, hopefully. Harold, what's your take on what's happening with Mr. Perry?
Well, you know, Tyler's doing what is working for him. As far as I know, he doesn't support any black theater. In fact, I heard somebody say that, you know, so this is kind of hearsay, that he doesn't support anything black. Now, somebody can contradict me. If they can come up with the evidence, fine. But we have only one black theater remaining in New Orleans, and the word was Tyler Perry was asked to help support the theater, and he declined, and instead supported a white theater company in Kenner, Louisiana. I don't understand it. But, you know, that's the way that goes. He can do what he wants, but as far as I know, Tyler Perry does not support black theater, especially in his hometown. I know that for a fact. He does not support black theater. So why should black people in New Orleans support Tyler Perry and that dumb shit he does? Sorry about the language, folks.
That's okay. We heard it before. Okay, so how do you think we should set a fire on this guy, let him know he's not doing what he's supposed to be doing? What would be your suggestion?
That's a tough thing, because a lot of our people probably support, you know, the Tyler Perry TV and motion picture stuff. I've gone to see some of his movies, and I've probably watched maybe one or two episodes of his theater things, but maybe the best thing people could do is contact Tyler Perry and let him know we need his support. Now, we may not be the people that are putting the money in his pocket, so he may not have any reason to want to support us, but we don't have any money. He has some money, so he should support his community. Maybe he doesn't consider it his community. Maybe he considers, because he was abused by somebody, that he need not support him. But I think it would be a good thing if people who have the level of success of a Tyler Perry, it would be a good thing if they would support the community from which they came.
Now, I want to ask you a question. You said that there's only one black film company, not black film company, theater company remaining in the city of New Orleans?
To my knowledge, the ABCT, or Anthony Bean Community Theater and Acting School, is the only remaining black theater company in New Orleans, and it's on shaky ground and could use some support. At one time, pre-Katrina, which is 2005, there were many black theater companies, little ones. There were some established ones before that, Dashiki Project Theater, the Ethiopian Theater, they're the ones with the long track records, but they don't exist anymore. Jomo Kenyatta Bean and Anthony Bean, who founded the Ethiopian Theater, are no longer around. At least Jomo Kenyatta Bean recently passed away. Anthony Bean is running the Anthony Bean Community Theater and Acting School, doing a wonderful job with kids. He works with kids. His acting school is primarily children, and he does a great job with them. But I don't know how long they can survive on the handouts they receive from the city and wherever they get their funding. I don't know, but it isn't much, and it isn't enough, because they have a tremendous debt load in terms of rent and expenses, but we need more support for black theater, especially in New Orleans, which is primarily a black city. I don't understand it. Maybe the fault lies with the black community. We should say, we see the enemy and it is us. We have no money, and theater takes money. It's expensive to produce theater. That's why you don't have a lot of active theater companies. They don't have the money.
Okay, I can understand that. There is an attack on the arts in general among certain circles in the government, for sure. I think the guy that ran for president, Mr. what is his name, Romney, yeah, he was going to get rid of Big Bird and all kinds of good stuff like that. So, fortunately, he didn't win, because I'm sure public broadcasting would have really been hurting at that point. As we progress, I would love to see more black involvement in theater in San Francisco. Also, we have the Lorraine Hansberry Theater, which puts on quite a few shows, especially during the holiday season, which we're experiencing now. But anyway, funding would be a problem. I can see that. But as you pointed out, I think very articulately, it takes support from our black community also to make these things work. Charity begins at home or something like that. Mm-hmm. So hopefully we can put this out and get more interest. I don't see that Tyler Perry is going to pick up his remote and turn us on and say, oh my God, I haven't been giving New Orleans any money, and then all of a sudden you guys are going to get some funding. But mm-hmm. I think that people need to know exactly what is going on, and we appreciate your input into this. Do you have anything that you'd like to add to that?
Only that if, and Tyler Perry is just one person, there are other people, black people, African Americans, whatever the hell they want to call themselves, who are doing fairly well in that industry, and it would be helpful if they would support black theater in this country. They're making money, and maybe they feel their money isn't coming from the black community, so they don't owe anything to the black community. I can understand that. But on the other hand, on the real side, it would be a reasonable thing if they would support community theater in the communities that they came from, or in communities where black theater or African American theater is being produced. It would be a very helpful thing, especially in the city of New Orleans.
Now you have, you're in rehearsal, I understand, right now for a play that's coming up. Would you tell us who's doing that, when they're doing it, and what your involvement is?
Well, a production company I'm working with, a theater company, Voices in the Dark, and the Joy Theater in New Orleans are co-producing a play called Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. You might remember the movie from many years ago. I saw it when I was a kid. And this play will be staged in February of 2013, if we're still alive. And it will be at the Joy Theater on world-famous Canal Street.
Now, let me ask you a question. I don't want to cut you off in the middle of that. But you got the Super Bowl coming. You got Mardi Gras coming. So is that in between there, or is right around the same time? Is all that's going to be happening?
It follows all of those things. Mardi Gras, the Super Bowl, and guess who's coming to dinner? So the Super Bowl, Mardi Gras, and guess who's coming to dinner? The stage play, we hope people will come out and see it. Maybe Tyler Perry will come out and see it. Maybe Denzel Washington will come out to see it. Maybe some of the other African-American stars who've filmed in New Orleans would come out and see it. Maybe some of the production companies which have filmed in New Orleans would have representatives come out and see it. It's a wonderful show. It's a good show. And one thing about the show, even though it may be considered period or age, it shows that nothing has changed as far as the racial situation in this country that we call the United States of America. And the election of Barack Obama, rather than proving that things have changed, indicates from all of the hostility he has received, even from those crumbs and bums in Congress whose only reason for living is to make Barack Obama an unsuccessful president. This is ridiculous. These people are idiots, and they will drag the country down. They would rather drag the country down than see an African-American president be successful. So we hope you come out to those people who will be in New Orleans, see the play Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, and see just how much so little has changed in terms of racial attitudes in the United States of America. So if there's an asteroid or a comet with our name on it, may it hit, and may it hit hard, if racial attitudes do not change in the United States of America. That's what I have to say on that.
Okay, I just wanted to add too, I guess I left New Orleans when I was 12 or 13 to go to San Francisco, and back then we weren't allowed to go to the Joy Theater. I don't want to call that progress that you're going to be able to give a play there now, but that's a step in the right direction, I guess.
So, we make baby steps, you know, before we make giant steps, so we'll take what we can get.
So I got a couple of little nephews. Hopefully one day they might even own the Joy Theater. So
there you go.
We'll see what happens with that.
Maybe.
Thank you very much, Howard. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Sonny.
Okay, we just got to talking about, we just finished talking about the unions, SAG in particular, that union, in regards to actors and working. How do you feel about, and I don't know what the relationship would be, but how do you feel about what Tyler Perry is doing and his efforts at becoming a major player in the film market?
Well, Tyler Perry is doing some nice things. I'm happy for him. He's a New Orleans boy, of course. And I support Tyler Perry for what he's doing. The big major studios are not going to put his material out there and distribute it and all of that. So he has to be sort of, I guess, in a sense, a lone wolf in the business. Making his own films. He's a writer, he's an actor, he's a producer, and that's pretty much what you have to be. More power to you, Tyler Perry. Just support some black theater companies in the country somewhere, especially in New Orleans. That would be good.
So I gather from what I hear you saying, he's not doing that?
You know, the excitement, rebellion, you know. Then they hear it, and they realize, they want to join this world. They want to be jazz musicians. They want to become part of something that's new and great. They have to sense that, and that these black people have to teach them.
And that's how it always is in myth. Cinderella, the one who you keep out and you push down and you kick, that's the one with the moral authority. With the gift. That's as old as night and day. That's as old as dust. And it's not about black or white. But here it is now, that same myth in black and white. If you're a trumpet player and you hear Louis Armstrong, you want to play like him. Not because he's black, because that's the greatest trumpet you've ever heard. That's what you want to play like.
It was by and for Negroes. And the white kids in short pants who went there, some of them on bicycles, to hear the music, had good reason to feel slightly uncomfortable until they had pushed their way close to the bandstand and had been recognized by Oliver. A nod or a wave of his hand was all that was necessary. Then the customers knew that the kids were all right. Night after night, we made the trip. We sat there, stiff with education, joy, and a licorice-tasting gin purchased from the waiters for $2 a pint. Oliver and Louis would roll on and on, piling up choruses with the rhythm section building the beat until the whole thing got inside your head and blew your brains out. Eddie Condon.
Young white musicians who had ventured to the South Side now started to develop their own brand of jazz. A blend of New Orleans music with a more agitated, aggressive, northern sound. It would soon be called Chicago Style.
as they began to develop, they did develop a style of their own idiosyncrasies, their own stylistic gambits. And they had a lot of feeling and energy, and they were wild men. You know, Eddie Condon said, when we came to town, the Republicans, you know, ran for cover. But when they were young, they were among the first to go out into this, explore this black music and try to claim it for themselves.
Chicago had become, one musician proudly remembered, the jazz capital of the United States. But while whites were able to go to the South Side and hear the music of King Oliver and Louis Armstrong, blacks were not welcome in any club downtown. There was, in fact, no jazz band in America in which blacks and whites played side by side.
Well, the rules said that we could not play together, black and whites together, but it had nothing to do with our respect for each other as musicians, individual musicians. So after hours, when the clubs would close, the musician, black and white, would get together. White musicians could come to the South Side, and after hours, when they got off from their jobs, they would come, and we would trade courses. And we would get some of the academics from the white musician, and then get some of the creativity from the black musician. And we had what we called breakfast dances. It went on 5 o'clock in the morning after everything was closed. And we had this great jam session going. And this is why Chicago was the basis of really putting this together, because we found out that music is an auditory art. We didn't care what color you were or where you came from, it's how you sound.
First met, Jazz and I, at a dance hall dive at the Barbary Coast. It screeched and bellowed at me from a trick platform in the middle of a smoke-hazed, beer-fumed room, and it hit me hard. Raucous? Yes. Crude? Undoubtedly. Musical? As sure as you live. Paul Whiteman.
Paul Whiteman was a formerly trained violinist from Colorado who abandoned a symphonic career after hearing a jazz band one night in San Francisco.
Absolutely knocked him out. It was so driving. It was so much fun. He got up that morning with the blues. He went home that night feeling floating, you know, and had a great time. Now, his way of thinking, because of his training, his background, his father as a music educator, playing viola in a symphony orchestra, immediately he is thinking not about playing it that way, but about converting it his way.
Whiteman was convinced that he could find a way to orchestrate jazz, to make it even more commercially viable, to retain its rhythm and harmony while rendering it as precise and predictable as classical music. His arrangements were intended, he said, to make a lady out of jazz.
His concern all the time was that this is an amazingly important art form. We just need to be able to score it. We need to be able to get teams of musicians who can play it. We just need to be able to take it from its primitive state.
His first big hit had come in 1920 with Whispering. Soothing, heavily orchestrated, it sold 2.5 million copies, more than 250 times what Armstrong and Oliver's Chimes Blues would sell. Paul Whiteman's orchestra soon became the most celebrated and most imitated in America, launching a whole new trend in society dance music. On February 12, 1924, a big crowd turned out to hear the Paul Whiteman Orchestra play what was billed as An Experiment in Modern Music at Aeolian Hall in New York City. The concert included a brand new specially commissioned work by a young New York songwriter, the son of Jewish immigrants named George Gershwin, who, like Duke Ellington, had spent hours listening to black piano players in Harlem. Gershwin's composition was something altogether new, a classical piece suffused with jazz feeling, and it would become one of the best-loved compositions in all of American music, Rhapsody in Blue. The concert was a huge success. 4 hours of elegant and orchestral music without a hint of improvisation. But almost immediately, Paul Whiteman was billed as the king of jazz.
And of course, it's driving many blacks at the time and since crazy because, you know, it's all too obvious. Paul, white man equals king of jazz. Whiteman himself actually never seems to have pretended to be any such thing.
Critics would one day accuse Whiteman of diluting jazz, of stealing from black Americans. But Whiteman himself always acknowledged the debt he owed.
White people went into jazz not with the idea that they were going to make fun of black people or that it was going to be degrading to black people, but that here was an art form that they were willing to take on its own terms and wanted to express and actually wanted to respect and elevate. This is what makes Paul Whiteman important. He wanted to take the music on something like its own terms. This was going to redound on everyone associated with this music, whether you're white or black.
Whiteman gave behind-the-scenes work to black arrangers and wanted to hire black musicians for his orchestra. But even in the jazz age, that was impossible. The same year as Whiteman's triumph at Aeolian Hall, a young black band leader named Fletcher Henderson opened at New York's premier ballroom, Roseland in Times Square, playing for white dancers only. Henderson was the soft-spoken son of a piano teacher and a school principal, and he had come north to New York to pursue a graduate degree in chemistry at Columbia. But when his savings ran out, he turned to music and was swept up in the jazz craze. At Roseland, he made himself famous for playing dance music with a polish unmatched by any other black bandleader since James Reese Europe.
There were two kings of the band scene in New York. There was the white king, Paul Whiteman, who had the best white musicians in the country, and there was Fletcher Henderson, the king of the black musicians, who had the best black musicians in the country. And they were friends, and they helped each other and traded arrangements and so forth.
One evening, Whiteman took his band to hear Henderson's, then told his men if Fletcher was a white man, he would be a millionaire. But like Duke Ellington, Henderson grew restless with the polite dance music he was playing. He was determined to create a style all his own, wanted to combine the elegance of his formal arrangements with something more exciting, more driving, more spontaneous. Fletcher Henderson began to look for a soloist, a jazz specialist, he called it, who could help him out. He knew of a trumpet player in King Oliver's band in Chicago, whose genius other musicians were beginning to talk about. It would take him a while, but when he persuaded that specialist to come to New York, it would change jazz forever.
Mm-hmm. Jazz is the ultimate temporal art form. It's about the human experience of time. How is time embodied? So you listen to Lewis playing a quarter note, and suddenly your whole experience of that day has changed. You hear him playing this one quarter note, and time is not moving along in the way that it normally moves along. He was the first person to embody abstraction musically. Other people used abstraction in music, but over time, composers would sit down and take an idea and toy with it over time. But Lewis could spontaneously take a melody and abstract it, that is, remove all the unessentials from this melody and be left with just this pure vision of what the melody could be.
His sound, more than anything, his sound had a light in it. That's the only way I can describe it. You can't practice to get that. It's a spiritual presence. And when that light is in your sound, it just, when you hear it, it attracts you.
For nearly 2 years, Louis Armstrong stayed in King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band. The band also included a piano player named Lil Hardin. She was unlike any woman Louis Armstrong had ever met.
All along, I've been hearing from all the musicians about Little Louie, and he's what a good trumpet player he was gonna be, Little Louie. So when he brought Little Louie over to the Dreamland to meet me, Little Louie was 226 pounds. So I said, Little Louie, I couldn't call him Little Louie, as big as he is. I wasn't impressed at all. I didn't like anything about him. I didn't like the way he's dressed. I didn't like the way he talked. Anyway, he came up on the bandstands, and I used to play, you know, girls wore garters, you know, on their stockings. So when I sit down to play, I would roll my stocking down so the garters below my knee. And first thing Louis spied was my knee, and he was looking. And I said, this guy's got ideas he better not put in words.
Lil Hardin was ambitious, articulate, and like Armstrong, unhappily married. Despite her first impression, she fell in love with him. On February 5th, 1924, Louis Armstrong, just divorced from his first wife, married Lil Hardin in Chicago. Once married, Lil went to work on her new husband.
Lil decided she was going to make Louis over, and she tried to get him to lose a little weight. She took him out and bought him some proper clothes so he looked more like a Chicago slick than a New Orleans hick. And then she decided, you know, that he ought to be out on his own. He ought to be out from underneath the wing of Joe Oliver.
I probably would have never paid any attention to Louis' playing if King Oliver hadn't said to me one night that Louis could play better than he could. He says, but as long as I keep him with me, he won't be able to get ahead of me. I'll still be the king.
Lil urged Armstrong to strike out on his own, but he was reluctant to leave the man he still called Mr. Joe. He owed him a lot, he said, and wasn't sure he could make it on his own. But Lil persisted. I don't want to be married to a second trumpet player, she told him. I want you to play first. Then, in the spring of 1924, Armstrong got an offer he could not ignore. Fletcher Henderson wanted him to come to New York. Like his arrival in Chicago 2 years earlier, Armstrong's debut in New York was not auspicious.
The drummer Kaiser Marshall had a car and brought us downtown to meet Louis. He was big and fat and wore high-top shoes with hooks in them. When I got a load of that, I said to myself, who in the hell is this guy? It can't be Louis Armstrong. Don Redman.
Louis Armstrong, raised poor on the streets of New Orleans, could not have been more different from his sophisticated new employer. But almost from the start, Armstrong was influencing every other jazz musician in town.
I came to New York in 1924, That was the first time that I heard Louis in person. So Fletcher didn't have no music for him at that period. So he was just sitting up there like this with his trumpet in his hand and waiting for his courses. So when he got his courses, he was standing up and playing like hell. And the people would just rave.
Armstrong's choruses transformed the band. Henderson's arranger, Don Redman, now began writing new pieces that showcased Armstrong's soaring horn and his unprecedented sense of rhythm, what Henderson himself called Armstrong's New Orleans punch and bounce.
One night at Roseland, Armstrong began Shanghai Shuffle. I think they made him play 10 choruses. And I stood silent, feeling almost bashful, asking myself if I would ever be able to attain a small part of Armstrong's greatness, Coleman Hawkins.
Armstrong transformed the orchestra, transformed all the musicians in it, and ultimately transformed all the musicians in New York who were playing jazz and even popular musicians. He brought, first of all, a tremendous rhythmic excitement. Armstrong was an economist, you know. He played very few notes, but every note counted and it stood for something. Then, equally important, he brought the blues. Armstrong demonstrated that the blues might be the greatest musical gift ever to come out of America. And he played it with such conviction and such feeling and force that everybody wanted that. I mean, Duke Ellington was already in New York. He was accompanying singers. He had a small band of his own, but he was missing something. He didn't know what he was missing until he heard Armstrong.
Armstrong's great contribution is impossible to notate, but it is the characteristic that most clearly defines jazz. Swing.
Swing is getting the right note at the right time, not before or not after. So in jazz, which is a rhythmic music, you've got to have the time and you got to have the pulse. You're gonna be playing, you say, do 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 do. You can't say do 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 do. You gotta say do 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 do. She do be do do do. That, keep that going. Don't move that way. And believe me when I tell you, that's like a heartbeat, and you look at the audience, they'll get it, and you see them first start patting their foot, and then you're going to see they're going to get up, and they're going to start swinging around. That's what makes jazz so unique and so great.
No one, one musician said, knew what swinging was till Louis came along.
Louis Armstrong's arrival in September of 24 is pivotal because he's the most important jazz musician on the face of the earth, and he's coming to the country's biggest city, playing with its most important band and teaching them how to swing. Uptown, he plays dances for the young black adolescents and turns careers around like Rex Stewart's, Gene Rogers, and the man who played in the saxophone section for Duke Ellington, Russell Proko. He was a violinist when he heard Fat Armstrong, and he said, oh man, I'm going with a horn that you can make this music with, and he switched to alto saxophone. Plus, New York was the hotbed of recording activity, and the great Louis Armstrong gets to make freelance record dates. He records with Bessie Smith and Ma Rainey, and Clarence Williams' Blue Five with Sidney Bechet, and those records get to audiences who can't even make it to Roseland or go uptown. Jazz arrives because Louis came to New York and taught the world to swing.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a little trip through the jungle this time, and we want y'all to travel with us. That tiger's running so fast, we're going to take a few choruses to catch him. So I want y'all to come with me. Yes, sir. Peter, the sound of the trumpet's going to get away for you this time. Let out there, boys. I'm ready. Yeah.
Thank you.
Louis Armstrong invented a new style of playing. Louis Armstrong created the coherent solo. Louis Armstrong fused the sound of the blues with the American popular song. Louis Armstrong extended the range of the trumpet. Louis Armstrong created the melodic and rhythmic vocabulary that all of the big bands wrote music out of.
I think Armstrong boils down to how do you define genius? And I guess it's partly that you hear something that no one else has heard. He heard rhythms and melodies and a sound, a way of extending his voice into the trumpet, all of which was original with him. And the result is so overpowering and so spiritual, it's enough to make the angels weep.
Okay, I hope you enjoyed hearing from Mr. Evans. Harold is a very good friend of mine, and he's also a relative. And he has been in the theater business for a while now. He's one of New Orleans' premier stand-in actors, if you will. He also runs a theater company and curtain call productions, and they're a low-budget operation. And as a matter of fact, I'm not sure if he's not a non-profit or what have you, but anyway, they do some good stuff down in New Orleans, so if you have a chance. And they're going to have a play coming up. Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, I think. And he mentions that on one of the clips. But Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, I saw that a long, long time ago when I was a kid with Sidney Poitier, Katharine Hepburn, and Spencer Tracy, I think. But anyway, that's what's going to be going on in New Orleans. And if you get a chance, Curtain Call Productions is what they're called. And they're going to be doing this play at the Joy Theater in New Orleans, and hopefully theater will come back to that city after Katrina ran a lot of people off. The reconstruction efforts are tremendous. As I understand it, New Orleans has the largest growing economy in the country of any city, and it's inevitable by the construction that is taking place as you ride through the streets of New Orleans. Now, back to San Francisco. We are going to have Black History Celebration at Hamilton Recreation Center, 1900 Gary Boulevard. And I will continue to tell you that until you show up, because we need you to come out and participate. Marcus Garvey made a very, very profound statement. I have it here somewhere. And I think it says something like, are people without the knowledge of their past history, origin, and culture is like a tree without a root. So I interpret that to say, if you don't know where you came from, you don't know where you're going. And if you have shallow roots, that's a lot different from having no roots at all. And I'm sure that we're connected to somebody somewhere. And a lot of this has been distorted. It's been hidden from us, and we haven't been told the truth. So now is the time to come out, participate. If you have anything that you want to contribute to this, we're more than happy to have you there. We don't have a lot of a big budget, but it's a community effort, and we ask people to come out and join us for Black History Month celebration. That'll be on February the 16th. From 1 until 4 at the Hamilton Recreation Center. If you have any questions, you can contact Ms. Renee Strong at 292-2111. Or you can call Nidra Harris at 415-368-9636. And if push comes to shove, you can email me at sfdominoclub. It's one word, sfdominoclub@gmail.com. We also have a website up, www.sanfranciscodominoclub.sfdominoclub.org. There's not a lot to see on it, but there's a page or two up, and I'm still working on it. It took me a year and a half to get there, but We're still working on it. If you have any ideas or if you can help us out, we'd appreciate that to get the website up, because that gets the word out. And right now, we are in the process of trying to give out some scholarships during our Black History Celebration. Maybe not this year, but next year we'll be prepared to do that. And as we continue on, we've done this now for the last 3 years. This will be our third year of Black History Celebration since James Pye died. But we intend very, very, very sincerely to continue his efforts and efforts of those who are interested in our folks. Once again, happy birthday to Dr. Martin Luther King. We hope that you enjoy his birthday, which is January 15th. The official celebration will be the following Monday. Everybody gets that Monday off, and so it should be. I think that he is the only African American to have a holiday in his name, and the contributions that we have made to this country, it befuddles me that this is one individual. I also read that in Time magazine, there have only been two African Americans on the cover of Time magazine since its existence. Those two people were Martin Luther King, and I'll let you guess who the other person was. Anyway, while you're chewing on that, I'm going to get out of here and wish you a Happy New Year once again. Keep on keeping on, and I hope that you will continue to watch channels 29 and 76. And our thanks goes out to Bayback for allowing us to come to you on a regular basis. We appreciate it. May God bless you. Thank you.